Well, thanks, everybody. My name is Jeff Luszcz. I'm the founder of Palamida. I also head up our professional services team. So it's my team that helps companies roll out the Palamida product, as well as helps companies perform software due diligences, open source audits, code comparisons, et cetera. Anything that may be involved for looking for open source code or third-party code in a code base, whether it's for merger and acquisition, or just as part of your standard baseline internal use of your own code. Well, last month was a pretty impressive month, I think, for the open source world, especially the open source security world. And as many of you know, maybe all of you know, there was a very serious vulnerability discovered in a version of OpenSSL. And what we found is that the vast majority of software companies were just not able to answer the question right away, are we using OpenSSL? And if we are using OpenSSL, what versions are we using? Where are we using it? How are we using it, et cetera? It was just not something that bubbled up to the top of their lists. It was not something that was easily answered. And everybody in some ways thought it was going to be easily answered. When the CEO talked to the VP of engineering, he talked to the CTO and said, where are we using OpenSSL? The expectation was that this was going to be something that was already in a bill of materials, or it was just something that these people had at the tip of their tongues and could just easily, crisply reply and say, oh, of course, I know where we have OpenSSL. We have it here, 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 and here, or we're not using OpenSSL at all. But it didn't go down like that. There was a lot of late nights. There was a lot of emails. There was a lot of code reviews and discussions and emails to outside vendors. And even then, there wasn't always good, crisp answers. There was a lot of, we're working on it, or there was a lot of, we don't think we're affected, but we'll let you know, followed by, oh, actually, we are affected, and here's the cases that we have. And even a couple pullbacks where people said, oh, we are affected by this, and then it turns out that they weren't. For many people, this was the first inkling that they were using a lot more open source, a lot more third-party packages than they knew about. You know, if you've been coming to the Palamida webinars for a while, you know that's probably old hat, old news to you. For the vast majority of software companies, I think this was a wake-up call. They didn't know what they were using. They didn't know how they were using it. And they found out that their engineering teams could not answer that question very quickly. So today's webinar is really designed to talk about what can you do to talk to your organizations. What are questions you can ask your development teams? And then we also talk about some common areas of concern. If you're new to the open source world, even if you're not new, but you just have a lot to work through, what are some ways of triaging your projects? What are some areas to look at first before you get too deep into maybe the weeds? And what's some common vocabulary that we all can use to discuss these issues? So let's go to today's topic slide. Today's topics, we're basically going to go over a series of items. The first one is what is OpenSSL and Heartbleed? What is this component in the first place, if you're not familiar? Why weren't people tracking it? Why did people not even know that they were using OpenSSL? Talk a little bit about that. Maybe some lessons that we can learn that can help us understand where the next Heartbleed style defect may come from and how it's going to affect us. We'll talk about some common areas of concern and a couple ways that you can start doing your software reviews and software audits. Just basically a tear-off sheet of questions you can ask for your team. It's not an exhaustive list, but it's some good ways to start the conversation and start the journey in terms of getting your full stack exposed and walked through. And then we'll provide some time, as always, for some questions. So next slide here is, what is OpenSSL and Heartbleed? OpenSSL is a very famous cryptographic library. Basically, it is used by the vast majority of software companies out there to encrypt their data, very often in a web context. So if you see the HTTPS notice whenever you're on a website, things like that, those are all indicators that maybe OpenSSL is being used behind the scenes to encrypt this data. It has been around for a long time. It's been around since about 1998. and bits of it were available before as part of another open source project. And it has many, many, many versions and features added since then. And it is one of the most popular open source projects. Some data I've seen says that maybe two-thirds of all websites depend on it. I think the number is even higher if you look at not just the web servers, but the applications that are running. It touched a lot of our industry. I also thought it was very interesting when some of the statistics and information came out last year that basically OpenSSL, being an open source project, only had about $3,000 worth of donations to it last year. So if all the corporate users of OpenSSL, it powers two-thirds of the websites that are out there, they've only received direct contributions of about $2,000 U.S. cash all of last year. And I think that's kind of a sign of maybe a deeper problem in our industry, which is we've all moved over to using open source. Our statistics show that around what's called 50% of a standard application is open source. But as an industry, we really have not really been given back to the open source projects, perhaps in the way that we should. There's definitely a lot of time and energy being given, but maybe not a lot of money, maybe not a lot of high-level expertise, especially for projects like OpenSSL. It was Heartbleed itself, a great marketing term. I think that in some ways it was a very serious defect, and it had some very excellent marketing. Everybody was probably sitting, I think it was a Thursday or Friday night, sitting there and talking. I was talking at dinner, and everybody's looking at me saying, what is this? Explain this to me. The people who were not even in the tech industry were hearing about it and asking, should I be concerned? Should I change my passwords? So I think the way this defect was disclosed, because of its seriousness, really, really struck a nerve, not just the technical world, but I think a lot of the users of the Internet around the world. And the defect itself was introduced way back in 2012. I think it was March of 2012 is when it was introduced. And basically what the root of it was, it was a defect that allowed access to data through a buffer overread. Basically, you could reach and grab more data from the remote computer than the original author really wanted to give you. So maybe you only were supposed to get 32 kilobytes of information. You actually reach out and grab a lot more. And this allows you to grab secret data from memory, maybe passwords, maybe other things that would allow you to attack a system. And this is a very common defect. In some ways, it's not a surprise to see. It's a common failure mode. What was a surprise that it took basically 2 years for this to be discovered. It wasn't found by the vast majority of the software static analysis tools that look for bugs. It was kind of silently sitting there. And when it was discovered, it was seen as such a serious defect that the industry worked together to try to come and fix it in a coordinated fashion. There was a really great job done to populate, basically get well known that this was an issue, and in some ways to get the industry to treat it seriously. Just because there were patches made, but the open source project and the security community cannot force companies to update their software, but peer pressure and questions from the user base can. And I think this was just a very well coordinated defect and vulnerability in how it was managed. If you're a security researcher, if you're somebody who's tracking these things, it was given a name as part of the National Vulnerability Database, and its name is CVE-2014-0160. So it's a great, whether it's Heartbleed, kind of the popular name is Heartbleed, or the CVE is that. A little background there. So let's go to the next slide here, which is, what is it? Well, only certain versions of OpenSSL is effective. There's some fairly recent versions, so 101 through 101F were affected. Earlier versions and later versions were not affected by this defect. So they may have their own other defects. OpenSSL, I think it's seen as a very popular library. I think people consider it kind of one of the milestones of the open source world. But it's very complex. It has a very long history. It has a lot of moving pieces. It supports a lot of different software platforms. And because of this generalization and wide adoption, it actually has a lot of moving pieces that can cause problems for checking it for software defects or just understanding the complete attack surface that the library may have. And since it is powers so many sites, there are only always people banging on it, looking for defects, looking for holes in it. And it doesn't say anything about the quality of the product, so people may have pluses or minuses about the software quality there. But anytime you find a library that is publishing, is basically powering two-thirds at least of the world's websites or products, you're going to have a large community looking at it to try to find holes and weaknesses. So let's go to the next slide here, which is, why weren't people tracking it? Well, what was the problem? Why wasn't it such a huge surprise and huge problem for people? Well, I would think here that the number one issue is that it's licensed under an attribution style license. Okay. If you're familiar with open source licensing, let's consider that there's maybe two big camps of licensing. There's the attribution style licensing, which says you can pretty much do anything you want with this library as long as you give us credit. As long as you just tell people, maybe in your about box or your documentation or on your website, that you're using this. The other style of licensing is what we call viral licensing or copyleft licensing. So if you're using this, you need to give some or all of the product away. Well, many people, if they're doing open source tracking it right now, they first start in, you know, they look for GPL issues. They're basically trying to make sure that they're not giving away the farm by including GPL, general public licensed content, copyleft content, in a place that they don't expect. And when they come across attribution licenses, like OpenSSL, it simply says, well, there's a series of obligations, but one of the main ones there is, and you can see here in the courier font, it says, you need to put in a statement that says, this product includes software developed by the OpenSSL project for use in the OpenSSL toolkit. That's one of the main obligations you're supposed to follow. It's an attribution obligation. And I would say the vast majority of software companies do not follow this obligation. They don't actively suppress it. They don't actively remove it. But when it comes down to, did they do any sort of affirmative action on following the obligations for attribution style licenses? I would say the vast majority of companies do not do anything. And so if the team who's been asked to do their open source reviews, make sure the open source licenses are being followed, if they're basically told, well, really concentrate on the viral issues, the copyleft issues, things like OpenSSL, get ignored, incorrectly get ignored. Well, let's go to the next slide here, which is more reasons why people weren't tracking it. Well, number one is most organizations are still not tracking the vast majority of their third-party software components. Now, Palamida data shows that the typical software company only knows about 10% of their actual bill of materials, their actual open source content. So if I just take a software company at random and ask them what they know about, then I come in with the Palamida tool and the Palamida team, and we produce an accurate, real bill of materials. They've undercounted by 90%. And so the first thing is people aren't tracking libraries, so therefore they can't even tell you if that library is in use or not. So if I say, are you using zlib? They can't tell you unless they do an active review. If you're using OpenSSL, like last month, the big question, couldn't tell you without doing an actual review of the currently shipping product. And if you look at then an install base, what product have we ever shipped with any open source? And where are they in our user base right now? That's a much bigger problem. And companies, I think, are still trying to figure out what the answer is for Heartbleed and OpenSSL at this point, the vast majority of their user base. So number one is people just aren't tracking open source right now. That's a big problem. It's a problem for license compliance, but also rears its head as a problem for vulnerabilities. If you don't know you're using something, you can't patch it. You can't route around it. Number two is even if you are tracking things, many organizations are not respecting the attribution style open source licenses. So even if they're tracking things, they're only looking at the most serious, the priority one and priority two issues. they have not been able to handle the priority three issues yet, or they just haven't told their staff that they really need to respect all of those. These typically run to the dozens or hundreds of libraries, and for many legal organizations and many engineering organizations, that's still maybe too high of a number for them to feel like they can handle it right now. That has to change because of things like Heartbleed, because of just basic respecting the licenses. But in some ways, that's what we're seeing out in the industry. The next item is that things like OpenSSL are often contained inside of separate third-party products. So you might be using the Apache web server. That might be the thing that you're tracking. But OpenSSL is buried deep inside of it in certain modules. And so it's hidden from easy view. So if you ask your team, saying, are we using OpenSSL, and they look down their list of top-level software components, they might not see OpenSSL listed there. But it's a subcomponent of the library you're using. So you may be affected, but it may not be visible to you. And then lastly here is, especially more and more times these days, is that many organizations have a very deep software stack. So if you look at the very bottom, it goes from their firmware up to their Linux, their kernel, their operating system, their libraries, their databases, their own applications, their utilities, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That full stack is managed by different teams with different responsibilities and different reporting structures. And when it comes down to it, you say, where are we using OpenSSL? Sometimes security and legal is only talking to one part of the stack owners there, and you don't get a complete answer. So all of these things wrapped together mean it was very difficult for people to find OpenSSL and what version and where they were using it. Let's go to the next slide and say, what can this tell us about the next Heartbleed? It's going to come. Whenever you have what's called a monoculture, like OpenSSL, where the vast majority of products of software companies are dependent on a small list of open source projects, operating systems, or modules, databases, whatever, there will be another defect like Heartbleed that is going to affect whether it's 10%, 50%, or two-thirds of the software that's out there, with a defect like Heartbleed, kind of a zero-day attack that can just silently be used to get into the system. So as we just talked about, most companies' software bill of materials only contain less than 10% of their true bill of materials. So if a new vulnerability is found in the wild, there's a very low chance. So is it 10% chance, 1% chance of having it on your list of known items? So if it's on day zero, and you don't currently have a good list of known open source and commercial code, and somebody says, are we using OpenSSL? Are we using zlib version 1.2.5? Whatever the next issue may be, if your list is too short, you're not going to be able to answer it. You're just going to have to do all that work all over again. And especially in the type of analysis that's done in response to a vulnerability, what we typically see is people are not building full bill of materials, they're just doing targeted analysis. Where are we using OpenSSL 101? Not show me all the open source that we're using. If you're currently only tracking open source packages with strong licensing, so copyleft licensing, LGPL, GPL, maybe the non-standard licenses, maybe commercial licenses, and you're just leaving the dozens, if not hundreds, of packages that have more permissive style licenses, the Apache or BSD style licenses, off your list, you're not going to know it's there. And so when people are saying, are we affected, your list is, if you are doing analysis, but you're prioritizing your analysis, which is a pragmatic decision, you still can't answer that question, are we using it? So where do I think the next kind of Heartbleed style defect may be coming from? I wouldn't be surprised if it's a very popular permissively licensed component again. It just hasn't been tracked because it's falling under the radar. Very often these libraries, the ones that are being used by everybody, are very commonly reused or remixed. And they're going to be overlooked if people are looking for it because it is inside of another package. It's compiled into a binary, or it's a binary of a binary of a binary, subcomponent of a subcomponent of a subcomponent. And this is why binary analysis is very important. If you're just looking for the source code for OpenSSL, you're not going to find all the cases where it affects you. If you're just looking for across disclosure lists of your commercial products for OpenSSL, you're not going to find every case because every company is the same. They're only counting maybe 10% of their code unless they're in a very rarefied world right now. So disclosures are not sufficient to see if you're affected. Source code analysis is not sufficient to see if you're affected. You got affected. You need to look at the binary world. And even there, you may need to press and poke to see if there's something that maybe the binaries have been stripped of their symbols. Maybe there's a web service that's being called that actually is affected by the defect, but you're not seeing it in the code base. The other thing I think is very interesting is very often we see engineering teams say, well, we'll just always stay current. You know, defects are being found, we're always going to stay current. We're going to add, a new version comes out, we'll update. But what was interesting about the Heartbleed bug is that it was due to a new feature added in 2012. There was this idea of let's add a heartbeat feature to the product. And it's a new feature, and as soon as that feature was introduced, the defect was introduced. And so the people who are members of the Update Early and Update Often Club, those are folks that may be affected. You've updated, you're on the head of the tree. Well, what's good about the head of the tree is hopefully all the old defects that have been reported are cleaned out. The problem with being in the head of the tree is any new features that have been added have not been really hammered on it and looked at by the security community. And this definitely can lead to new defects being introduced and being exploited. So there is this trade-off here. You know, very often people don't even know they're using open source. They don't update it, and they're stuck with ancient defects that people can exploit. We also have the folks who are going to update everything. Much like on your phone, if you see that there's updates available on your phone and you say accept all, well, sometimes you're going to get a product that's not as good as the one you had before because they've added features or they've removed features or they've introduced defects. Same thing with the open source world. So the takeaway from this is we have to make sure that our bill of materials are getting bigger and bigger and more accurate every month, every year. It's okay to start pragmatically to say, let's start with big rocks, let's start with the viral items, but we can't just stop. Your job's not done just because you found every priority one and priority two item in your code base, especially if you need to be nimble for security issues. Let's go to the next slide here, the common areas of concern. So one of the things I've seen over the last 10 years or so of doing this type of analysis, looking for open source issues, looking for vulnerabilities, seeing how it's affected people, there's been some commonalities that I've seen. This is not an exhaustive list, but it's designed to help you identify regions of your code base that are likely to be affected by security holes and vulnerabilities and often are going to be the kind of the indicator species, the leading indicators of places and problems that you may have with untracked open source. So, you know, this being Jeff Lish of Palamida, you know, I'm always going to say it's best to have a full accounting of all your third-party software. And you notice that full has quotes around it. We'll talk about what a full audit may mean and how it's actually difficult to always have a quote-unquote full audit, but you can try to approach it as you can. So there are certain components that I would put on my list of you should track these no matter what your ability to track all your components. That you should front load certain items because they traditionally are banged on more by the security community, that they're investigated more by the hacker community, and they have some very common open source vulnerabilities that have been highlighted and fixed. They're often overlooked by the engineering team. So the first one is cryptographic components, OpenSSL, other things like that. They, by their very nature, are going to be placed in the most sensitive part of your products. They're going to have access to the most sensitive secrets, like passwords, usernames. If cracked, they provide basically open access to the secrets of your code base. Well, they're very often targeted by the hacker community, by the exploit people that exploit this, as well as security researchers. Security researchers are going to be looking at these components day in and day out. It's a great way to make your reputation by finding a serious problem. It's a great way to make the whole thing, but it's also a great way to make sure these things are clean and safe. You also have a legal tracking requirement for export. So if you're in the United States and you're dealing with crypto code, there's typically a export requirement to tell the government what type of cryptographic components are in your product if you're shipping it overseas. So you kind of have a double reason to be looking here. One is you're expected to be looking anyway. I guess three reasons. There's export control issues. There's the classic open source issues. You're supposed to be recording and respecting these licenses anyway. And then there's the fact that these things are just going to be highly targeted. So anything dealing with crypto should be at the top of your list, no matter what its license is, no matter what its prioritization is. It's the public domain crypto. You still should know where it is because it's going to be highly targeted for hacking analysis. If you have your own crypto that you've written, maybe 5 years ago, 10 years ago, this is a place you should be tracking as well. Not just the open source crypto, but commercial crypto purchased 5 or 10 years ago, homegrown crypto written over the 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. Those are all places that may be slipping under the radar that you should be aware of. Maybe nobody's been banging on it with a static analysis tool if it's homegrown. Maybe you the company you're working with just went out of business or hasn't been doing great security research themselves, and they're silent on known holes. So that is number one on the list of things that you should be tracking, even if you have hundreds of thousands of other open source projects, crypto's top of the list. Number two is somewhat related, is the compression components, the things that take data and make it smaller. So you might be familiar with zip compression for transferring email. That same compression is used to compress data when it's going over the wire from server to server, or it's used as the heart of certain image libraries to make sure that your large picture ends up being smaller when you save it and transport it. In some ways, they're very similar to cryptography in terms of the algorithms and the languages used, the programming techniques. Crypto and compression both aim to be very fast. They both aim to be very concise and as fast as possible. And they very often have to use these programming techniques that are hard to read and hard to understand to get this efficiency or to get this compression. And those are places where bugs can often get introduced. These are also highly targeted by the hacker-cracker community because they're everywhere. Any device that's out there right now almost certainly has some sort of compression library on it. So if you target some of those libraries and you find a defect, there's a great bang for your buck there. And another very similar item is multimedia components. These are components for viewing and saving image files, sound files, movie files. Very often, they're widely used. Anytime you have something that shows you an icon or an image or a photo or plays a sound, there's some multimedia library at play there. So pretty much any software that's out there that is not a command line tool is going to have some sort of multimedia library deep in the heart, even if it's as simple as showing a JPEG image or playing a WAV file. They often themselves contain crypto and compression routines, which is kind of neat. So if you're playing a movie, well, you need to compress that video to make it as small as possible. And there may be some crypto involved because the stream that you're playing, you don't want it intercepted by people who haven't paid for the movie, et cetera. So you're going to have all the issues from crypto, you're going to have all the issues from compression, as well as the additional items being introduced in the multimedia world. Those three items together, so crypto, compression, and multimedia, they're like cousins in my mind. They're very similar. They're very often found in the same products. There's a short list of well-known components, much like OpenSSL, that is used by pretty much everybody. And they're banged on by so many people. They often have programming optimizations that are going to cause defects at the, you know, sometimes security is at the expense of speed, is at the expense of security, and vice versa. If you get those on your list, you're going to be finding a lot of the serious issues that are affecting, not all, but many of the ones, especially ones that have been sitting there dormant for a long time. I can't tell you how many times I come into a code base and we look and we see yet another ancient version of zlib that has a horrible vulnerability in it, but it was fixed 10 years ago or 5 years ago. But it's been sitting in an untouched library for 5 years, 10 years, just because people were not aware that that component had a vulnerability or that it was even there in the first place. The next two common places that I highly recommend that you start poking around and making sure that your team is tracking and keeping you up to date is, first of all, the application platform. So this may be something like Tomcat, this may be something like Jetty, Geronimo, JBoss. You may want to consider this a Linux kernel. Whatever platform your system is running on, and we'll talk a little bit about some issues, you know, in discovering this in the first place. That is, they're again widely used. They often have contain crypto and compression themselves. They're very complex. They have a lot of little pieces. They also often have programming errors such as default passwords being left or sample applications not being removed before going to production that hackers and crackers can use to gain access. That's a surprise to the production users. They often have very many moving pieces. They, again, are often handled by a different team than maybe your dev team. We'll talk about that in the next slide or two. And then lastly, the databases. Pretty much anybody who's doing a non-trivial app has a database in use. And I'm always amazed when we find databases during our audits that was just not surfaced as part of the disclosures. If you're doing anything worth storing data, there's some sort of database, whether it's an embedded database, or a large SQL database, open source or commercial, whether it's Oracle, MySQL, SQLite, et cetera, it's there. And if your team hasn't told you about it, that's a problem. There's classic vulnerabilities, defects present in these going back in time. There's also misconfigurations. So if your team is not aware that they're using SQL databases, they're not keeping on track of the vulnerabilities there, you also might, your security team may not be doing all the things that they need to do in terms of securing the data when it's in transit, when it's at rest, et cetera. So these are the top five places where you should start. You shouldn't stop once you've hit all these five items, but if you're not aware of libraries of this type, you're setting yourselves up for having to scramble when the next Heartbleed style defect comes. So how do you start looking at this? Well, there's a couple ways. When I look at a code base, I very often talk about top-down and bottom-up approaches to finding out what's going on. And as you can see on the slide here, the diagram, we start at the top with your product. Where when somebody says, well, what is this, what's on this disk here? You can say, what's our product, version 1.0, version 2.0? That's the top-level view of the product. And then when you start to break it up, most people's applications are about 50% open source and third-party. So if you look and you see the explosion there from half of your product turning into that third-party OSS commercial piece, well, that helps you understand, well, what's our percentage coming from outside of our organization? And then that part right there is going to be broken up into what we call monolithic packages, which is often large source trees containing dozens to hundreds to thousands of files that are part of a single library. Or maybe it's zlib, maybe it's boost, maybe it's ffmpeg. Those may be names that you're familiar with. There may be single binaries, so an .exe or a .dll or a .jar that contain an open source product or a commercial product. Maybe a single file that was downloaded from the internet just to provide some single file functionality, utility functionality, and then some cut and paste. And typically what we see is the number of vulnerabilities is highest on the left-hand side and then gets smaller and smaller as you go to the right-hand side. The monolithic packages that have large source trees, the single binaries, those very often are going to contain the vast majority of your known open source vulnerabilities. As you start to look at single files and cut and paste, they may have vulnerabilities present in them if you run them through a static analysis tool, but they're traditionally not the open envelope, the open attack surface, that say having all of OpenSSL present or all of And as you keep going down, you're going to find that each of these libraries has subcomponents themselves. So if you look at zlib, zlib is made up of, let's call it 100 files that have various subcomponents themselves. Boost is made up of thousands of files. FFmpeg is contained thousands of files with other open source projects in it itself, so on and so on. And you can imagine, as you start to the top, the items that are higher in the stack are things that your development team are just going to maybe have at the tip of your tongue. If you pull everybody into the room, I call this the conference room effect, you say, let's start naming some open source that we have. You can go round robin for quite a while where people are able to name open source libraries that they know your product is using, even if it's not showing up on a bill of materials someplace. There's somebody who's downloaded it. There's somebody who made a request for it. There's somebody who's fixed a bug or patched it or whoever it may be. And they're going to know names like zlib, boost, FFmpeg, Apache Commons Codex, just off the tip of their tongue. They might not know all of the items. They may know many of them. And as you get lower and lower in the stack, things become a little bit more unclear to the dev teams, the developers, the security folks. But this is often where maybe an item at the very bottom may be causing a problem. So over the next couple of slides, we're going to talk about the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach for getting to a full bill of materials and for finding those types of issues that we talked about previously. So if we get the next slide here, the top-down and bottom-up approaches with the text. Basically, the top-down approach is a really good place to start. And I highly recommend that you start with some element of a top-down approach. Identify the big rocks that are present in the code base. It's a great way to build out your big bill of materials, but the types of items that are well-known to the team. And at the end, we'll talk about some questions that can be used to start this process. It finds the very well-known top-level components that have known vulnerabilities. You have an old version of MySQL, an old version of top-level zlib, an old version of FFmpeg. Maybe you have a new version of OpenSSL that has the Heartbleed bug. Those are all things where you look at the directory. Maybe there's a big directory that says third-party libraries. And you see the names and the versions. Just read down that list. It's a very quick way to build out a lot of your bill of materials at the top-level item. And then in parallel, there's the bottom-up approach. Well, the top-down approach is great for finding those big rocks, those well-known vulnerabilities. It often overlooks the things at the very bottom, things below the surface, that are actually causing the vulnerabilities in the first place. So these might be called the small rocks. So these are where you have potentially previously unknown vulnerabilities caused by embedded libraries. So maybe you pulled in a large open-source project, foolib version 5, that has dozens of open source subcomponents itself. So it's an open source library that has, let's call it, two dozen subcomponents that are open source libraries. And some of those subcomponents are things like zlib or libpng or FFmpeg or something like that, or OpenSSL. Well, the top level component may not have any vulnerabilities reported on it in the National Vulnerability Database. But if you look at its subcomponents, it may have an ancient version of zlib, an ancient version of libpng or FFmpeg that has vulnerabilities in it. It never bubbled up to the National Vulnerability Database. And with the proper knowledge and the proper tools, that they may be exploited to get it, basically make the entire component vulnerable. So foolib might be vulnerable because of an embedded version of OpenSSL or FFmpeg that you just weren't aware of because you were previously doing top-down analysis. So I think it's important to do both of these at the same time. I traditionally recommend people start with top-down analysis and do as much of that as they can, because those are the well-known attack surfaces that the community can see. They are the ones that the type of things that are going to bubble up to the well-known vulnerabilities right off. And you basically, no excuse. If your application platform has a horrible vulnerability and you just didn't even know about it, you should be addressing that before you start doing any sort of subcomponent analysis. But once you've gotten a lot of those big rocks lifted and rounded out, I would start doing the bottom-up analysis. Start looking for things like the crypto libraries, the multimedia libraries, compression libraries that are inside of those larger rocks that you have, and start to see if that's something you should be talking to the community about around vulnerabilities, or talking to your AppSec people to see if this component with the vulnerability is affecting the rest of your product. Just because you find a subcomponent that has a vulnerability doesn't mean everything is tainted. but it could be a sign that there are problems with that larger library. And I highly recommend that both approaches should be used with a bit of the top-down approach on Lotus. Go to the next slide here. So with the top-down approach, best way to attack this is walk through the common architectural modules and fill out a list as needed. So questions to ask. What databases are we using? What are we using for compression? What are we using for cryptography? What JavaScript frameworks are we using? And so on and so on and so on. And asking these probing questions with kind of almost an expectation that there's an answer for them. So what compression libraries are we using? Somebody's going to do research to find out the compression libraries. I find that if you say, are we using compression libraries? Are we using compression? Very often the flippant answer is going to be no. People don't remember it. But when you say, what compression libraries are we using? Someone's going to do a kind of an affirmative search, an actionable search to look for these things. And you should almost expect that the answer should be more than one. So what database are we using? If they come back and people say, oh, we're not using a database or there's only one item on it, that may not be complete, may not be sufficient. What are we using for compression? Oh, we're not using compression. Really? Are we doing network transport? Are we doing database access? Are we doing images? Yes. Well, then obviously we're doing some sort of compression. So it's good to ask these questions a couple times. Interview the developers, often multiple types of developers, high-level, low-level developers, QA people, et cetera. And then examine anything named common or third-party or utilities in your source code management system. Very often these open source libraries are just going to shout out and scream out at you. You're going to see a name and a version number. So zlib-1.2.5 or foolib version 3.1.2. That's a sign that's a library, third-party library, and it should be on your list, especially if it's sitting in a directory called third-party libraries. I'm always amazed when we get trees that say we have no open source. There's a big directory called third-party libraries, and there's 25, 50, 100 items there. In terms of the bottom-up analysis, I highly recommend that you target that crypto, compression, multimedia triplet, you know, via scanning, component search, so actively looking for things called zlib, actively looking for things called OpenSSL. String searching might be a case where you look for common encryption keys, Rheindahl, Twofish, maybe SSL, maybe password, maybe encryption. Those terms are going to find both your code and third-party code that may be related to one of these common libraries. Do some interviews if you can, but usually interviews are not going to find as much as doing the active searching. There's also a list of well-known libraries you should be looking at. Zlib, libpng, OpenSSL, FFmpeg, libtiff, etc. These are ones that if you're not doing a full analysis, you should front-load your analysis with these libraries. They are great libraries. They very often have great licensing. They are such a target for hacking and cracking. I would put them at the top of my list just to know what our awareness of all these items. Another thing that I often do is if people come in and say, well, where should I start? And I've done all these other things, what do I do next? Well, what are the oldest binaries that you have in your system? You have 15-year-old Windows DLLs. That might be a sign that something's been superseded. If you have trees that are version 1.0.0, of well-known open source projects, why haven't they been updated in 1 year, 5 years, 10 years? Great places to look. So next slide here about the deep stacks. And this is something that I've seen becoming more and more important, especially over the last year or two, where very often the legal teams or security teams, they're only talking to one of the teams in the software development world. And the different companies have different emphasis on who they talk to. Some teams talk to the programming teams, the developer teams. Other teams talk to more what I'd call almost the IT teams or the production teams. So let's talk about the stack for a second, and we'll go to a slide or two about what I mean. So a typical, if you're putting out a typical appliance or a typical server running your product out there, It may have a typical Linux stack, so there's going to be a firmware on the device that helps it boot. There's going to be the U-boot or bootloader on there that's going to bring things up from disk to start the operating system. You're going to have a kernel, maybe a Linux kernel, maybe Windows operating system, maybe something different. There'll be various drivers, so loadable kernel modules, things like that. There'll be the various system libraries and frameworks. So you might have a system level OpenSSL. You might have a system level database like MySQL that came, quote unquote, for free with your platform. Your developers maybe didn't make that choice, but the platform gave it to you. There may be various applications. And there'll be finally your own products and apps running on top of it. So this is a full stack. And very often, legal teams and security teams may be simply just talking at the top level, the company product and apps, and say, are you guys shipping or using OpenSSL? Nope, we don't have OpenSSL in our home tree. I grabbed for it. I don't see it in there. I don't see the binaries. Well, if you're using the system level OpenSSL library in your product, you might not see it in the actual bits of your product, but the calls may be there to the system level service. So that's a case where sometimes it's not being caught because you're talking only one team and looking at one of the boxes here. Other times you talk to a team who's more of the classic IT team. They know the operating system well. They don't know what's going on inside the application. It's a black box. And so they might say, oh, are we using OpenSSL? Oh, yeah, of course, we're using the great version that's here. But then they don't know that there's another version that's been packaged inside of the product, packaging inside the company product and not the OS. So this is the stack, and I would say traditionally, classic bill of materials have either come from the company product itself or from an IT person doing basically a rundown of, say, all the RPMs that they found in the IT system. But they very often do not have an overlap. Let's go to the next slide here. Because the deep stacks have many. Well, basically, these teams are typically unrelated. They often are in two different areas of the company. They have different management chains. And if you're just talking to one of them, things are going to fall between the cracks. This is a place where I still see OpenSSL being found now a month later, where the dev team says, we're not using OpenSSL. And then the stack team says, oh, we just got an alert from our operating system vendor or from our security tool that says we're still using a bad version of OpenSSL. And it's a big surprise because people said, I thought the app team told us we weren't using OpenSSL. Well, the app isn't, but the operating system is, or the application server is. So they're going to have different management structures. They have different legal context. They often have different understandings of open source licensing in the first place. Your app team may have a clearer understanding of open source licensing, while the IT side may be more of, hey, we just got something from Red Hat. We're using Red Hat version 10 or Red Hat version 12, whatever it may be. I didn't see any notice about glib or OpenSSL, et cetera, in the notes that I saw. Those are some things that require education, they require interviews, and they require kind of listening to both sides of the house there. You're going to know. Very often when I look at the disclosed bill of materials, when we talk to companies, you can really get a feeling for kind of the information architecture on the other side. Who are they talking to? Are they talking to the release team or are they talking to the development team? Depending on what you see on the bill of materials. So if the bill of materials is very RPM heavy, very Linux operating system heavy, so you see kernel and things like maybe databases, maybe RPMs, maybe things like that, that's going to tell you that you're talking the IT side, the release team side. If you see things that are software libraries, you see things that are coming from blogs or O'Reilly books, if I see maybe zlib, if I see code from Stack Overflow, if I see a file here, a single file from open source project, that's going to tell me that I'm listening more to the development side of the house. And you need both sides. You need the head and the heart. You need the yin and the yang to really get a good feeling for what your security list here. And what I very often see is a good list from one team is often confused for a good list from the actual product team. So when somebody says, oh, we have a really good understanding of our open source, and you go look at it, you may have a really good understanding of your operating system's open source, but absolutely no understanding of the open source used by your product, and vice versa. I think it's sometimes a bigger sin to not know what's going on inside your product, because that nobody else is looking there. Your operating system vendor may be giving you automatic updates or alerts or things like that. So, well, good to have an understanding of what's going on there. Somebody else may be looking out for you there. In terms of your own product, there's only one person looking out for you. It's you. And the Linux distribution often leads to long lists of open source components, dozens, hundreds of lists. And people say, well, that's a great, look at this great list we have. Well, it's part of your Linux OS. It is not always the attack surface for your product itself. They may be things that may not even be visible to the outside customer. If you're tracking things like LS and grep and more and this, those are things that maybe are just quiet on the disk or never actually exercised during the execution of your product. They're part of the stack that was delivered to you, and they've been on your bill of materials. You know, I think over the next year or two or three, we're going to see more and more of these lists get longer and longer with more of a description of how they're being used. Is it part of the core OS? Is it part of your product? Is it actually being exercised at runtime? That's where I think we need to go to better understand the impact. I would, again, much like the top-down and bottom-up approach, I think there's elements of both that you need to look here. You need to look at your product list. You know, very often focus on that top five list of things, crypto, compression, multimedia. And the same thing on your Linux side or your operating system side. What are those five areas that are there, especially if they're being exercised at runtime, or if they're providing system level services to the outside world. And with that, that brings us to the last page here, which is some questions to ask your development team. And not all these questions need to be answered, but I often use these as leading indicators of where's my team at, or where's the team I'm working with at. So the number one is always, do we have a list of open source and commercial libraries we're using? You know, and how big is it? If it's less than a couple dozen items, I'm going to take that as a sign that you probably should add a zero to the end of it. If somebody comes back and says, here's our list, and it's 20 items or 50 items, my experience is usually that's only going to be 10% of your true number. So it's good to know what's going on there. It's good to kind of get a feeling for what type of items are being disclosed. But if it's just, you know, we're using Apache Commons, Kodak, and JBoss, and MySQL, and you're not seeing anything more than that, it's an undercount. How deep have we looked, and how complete is this list? Where have we looked? Who produced this list? Is that coming from the app side? Is it coming from the IT side? Was this passed on to us from a vendor or not? Those top four or five items we talked about before, explicitly ask, what crypto libraries are you using? What compression libraries are you using? So on and so on. And if the answer comes back as zero, no list, nothing, I would be suspicious. But, you know, unless you are a very small app, a toy app, or a very esoteric app, almost certainly you're going to be using one of these items in your stack. A very commonly overlooked thing here is things being brought in by external repository managers. So you push a button at build time and you bring in 100 or 200 or 600 libraries that are coming from the open source world. These all have their own bill of materials. They have their own vulnerabilities. They have their own licenses. And if you're just looking at what's in source code management, you're grepping, you're scanning, whatever, you're going to miss a lot of this content. And it's often these days somebody pushes a button, and you next thing you know, you have 100, 200, 300 items you didn't know about before. So easy to pull these dependencies. And what's good is they very often are going to be coming head of tree, nice new versions. But as we talked about before, sometimes those new versions are going to be adding vulnerabilities to the access to new features. Web services are very important because the web services may have these vulnerable open source components behind them. So if you're working with another vendor, and they don't have their OpenSSL situation under control, you may just know them as the GIS lookup web service, or the analytics web service, or the currency exchange web service. But people may be able to use that to get into your system, or there may be a vulnerability there that allows them to return SQL injections, or whatever else it may be, into your system there. So it's good to know all your moving pieces, and then to find the places where somebody else is running code that you do not have control over. And I think that's going to be, especially over the next couple of years, become a much more important, especially for large companies who maybe get a much better job of handling their internal use. And as they start to interact with outside ad networks, and they start to work with outside analytics and web services, that's another attack vector on them. Okay. Databases, what are they? Almost certainly it's going to be more than one, SQL, NoSQL, embedded, whatever. Many commercial products ship with their own embedded database that you may not be aware of that is not going to be updated in the same way that your standard database is. You put some pressure on your vendors to get a good exhaustive open source list and ask these same questions, compression, database, stack, multimedia to them as well, and force them to basically get you a much better bill of materials. Do your own light audits. Find 1, 2, 3 items. Find a zlib, find a libpng that they didn't tell you about. That opens up the conversation that they're not doing the right job for you. VMs and applications are being shipped to the customers. Which ones are they? Are we shipping virtual machines? If so, what operating system's on it? These are all things that may introduce that next level, that IT stack of vulnerabilities that you weren't tracking. What is the full stack? Draw that diagram we showed on the board that goes from firmware all the way up to your application. Have people fill in names. Have people draw their own block diagram of the architecture and see what's going on. And then lastly, definitely push on that disclosure unless you're with commercial vendors. And go back to the well many, many times. The first time you ask, you're going to get a much, much shorter list that's really there. But with that, in the interest of time, we're going to turn this over to any questions. And Stacy, I think if you have any questions, go with them.
So just give it a second for anyone to ask any questions on their GoToWebinar client. And if so, I'll just read those out.
And we always welcome questions either on the call now, and very often I'll get questions in email on the phone afterward, and we welcome those as well. So basically, maybe you go to the contact slide here as well. Please feel free to send them. This is Jeff here. Any direct questions? These slides will be available as well as always afterward on the Palamida.com website, and the video should be available as well. Okay. If we don't have any questions, I really thank everybody for their time, especially after this 3-day weekend. And I welcome any feedback or questions or updates to the slides here. If you found this useful, please let me know. And we strive to make this an interesting webinar series for people to join.
Thanks so much, Jeff. Thanks, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, Stacey. Thanks, everyone. Talk to you soon.
Okay. Bye-bye.